Hello, and welcome to the Block Solid podcast, where we talk about the evolution of the property market, the newest technologies that enhance and revolutionize the world of real estate as we know it, and how we, the owners, the buyers, the renters, the investors, and the entrepreneurs can benefit from it all. I'm Yael Tamar, CMO and co-founder of Solid Block, pioneer in real estate tokenization, and I'd like to welcome Nicole Bremner, today's episode special guest. Hi, Nicole.
Hi, Yael. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. How are you doing today?
Yeah, good on this very gloomy, rainy day.
It's the same here. I'm sure 20 degrees warmer, but it's the same here today for a change, right? So awesome. So Nicole is a property development specialist who founded East 8, a boutique property development and investment company with a proven track record in renovating million-pound properties across London. Her career journey went along a rather interesting path that included working in banking for a while, cooking, photography, and knitting, and was a stay-at-home mother too, all before finally settling on property development. She quickly learned that her love of architecture and her knowledge in finance were a great combination for operating a successful business in the field. Today, she's raising four young children and is the acting director of East 8 and is an adventurous amateur sailor together with her husband. She also runs her own podcast channel interviewing people from all industries, a successful author, and a non-executive director on the boards of several companies. She's also a startup investor. I have no idea how she does it all, but we're about to find out. So Nicole, you have certainly taken a roundabout way to get to where you are today. Were all the stages in your career connected with one leading to another, or did you have to start over each time and reinvent yourself?
Yeah, no, it's very much start over and reinvent myself. And I think that as you can hear from that bio, it's quite disjointed and also probably a jack of all trades, master of none is probably what sums me up. I think that some people are fortunate enough to find something that really clicks quite early on in their life and they're very good at and they're able to run with it. I never really found that thing until property, and I really enjoyed that. But just to go back a bit, I first qualified in Australia, in Sydney, as a financial advisor, as an individual financial advisor. And I then never, ever got to work in that field properly because I then moved to London. And then in London, I arrived in 2000 as the tech bubble burst, which wasn't very good for trying to find a job in banking, especially with Australian qualifications that weren't that good. Everyone said, oh, what university is that? Never heard of that. So it wasn't a great time to find a job. I ended up working on a gym floor, picking up dirty towels off the floor, just trying to work out what to do. And eventually, with a lot of hard graft, I did get a good job at the leading fund manager at the time, Capital. And that was a really good job. And then we were transferred to New York, worked in New York, had a baby over there, worked at Goldman Sachs very, very briefly. But again, it was the day I started at Goldman was the day that Lehman Brothers collapsed in September 2008.
So you, and you're single-handedly responsible for the collapse of Lehman Brothers?
Yeah, and perhaps the property market too, because as soon as I invested all in the property market in London, that all tanked as well. So
don't invest in Bitcoin. Don't invest in Bitcoin because we don't want Bitcoin to crash again.
Isn't it already down?
It's back up. It's on the run again. Yes.
Oh, wow.
As of today, as of this morning, 14th of January. Right.
Oh, wow. Okay. So, yeah, I think to answer your question, it took me a long time to find my thing. And I was fortunate to meet a lot of great people along the way and make a bit of money and then invest that money. And that's pretty much where it's got me now.
That's awesome. So while you're reinventing yourself, how do you choose the new industry? Is it passion driven or is it trend driven?
Probably passion driven, because when I had my first child, then we moved back to London and found out I was pregnant with number two. And at that point in time, realized there's no way I could go back into banking. And honestly, as I said before, I just wasn't that good at it. And I found it all a little pointless as well. At that point in time, bought a house that was a derelict vicarage, started renovating that and just loved it. I loved bricks and mortar and I loved renovating something that was so unloved and bringing it back to life for future generations. And loved that experience. Had my third child. And that's when my partner just said to me, why don't you do this full time? You love it. But I didn't know that field even existed. I knew that the big Barclay Homes and these sorts of companies existed and that they built homes. I didn't realize that people like me could do that. So yeah, I tried everything. I tried cooking. I tried blogging. It was the time of cupcakes back in early 2010s. And yeah, I just tried all sorts of things, but nothing would gain any traction. And then as soon as I started in property, I loved it. And I think I really found a niche that worked for a while. And that was sort of in 2012, 13, 14, 15, which is buying big unloved homes in central London and renovating them to become luxury family homes. And that worked really well. And that was sort of my first step into property.
Awesome. So you got into real estate investing after renovating a home. And I wanted to ask you how you got into startups. Did you have a startup of your own?
Yeah, I kind of dabbled in a startup in 2005 to 2009. And it was an online fashion retailer for British designers that before the time of social media. So it was really an interesting time to market because the only thing you had at that time was newsletter marketing. So it was a very different time. So I dabbled in that and I sold off parts of that business in 2008-09 when we moved to the US. And then I was approached just numerous times by startups about investing in them. And that's when I came across Bamboo Auctions, which as an Australian, most of the properties in Australia are sold via auction. And so I always thought that it was strange that it was not so prevalent here in the UK as it is in, say, in the US as well. So it really piqued my interest. And also the founder, Robin Rathore, we started this Twitter conversation and he said that the majority of bidders online were female. And yet, if you go into the auction rooms, there are hardly any women there. And we had this conversation about why it was that women felt so much more comfortable bidding online when they're not comfortable being in the room. So that sort of started the conversation. And I really believed in the concept. So I invested in it. I took up 10%. I think I'm down now. They've done a couple of raises recently. So I'm down to around 8% of that company. But it's done really well over lockdown, of course, because no one's allowed to be in physical auction rooms. So for them, while it's been a really tragic time for us all as a whole, for them, they've done incredibly well for over this time.
Yeah, that's one example on basically how companies come ahead of the trend, you know, this trend being forced on us. But the interesting thing about this whole COVID catastrophe globally is that it forced us into this digital transformation and things that people thought they couldn't do online, right? That they had to be done offline. Now they see that it's all possible. I hope that the school goes back offline. That's my biggest worry, you know. It got to be challenging with 4 young children, I'm sure. So let's hope that part remains out of the house. I want to go back to real estate for a minute. So if you could choose one area of real estate, either commercial, hospitality, residential, to invest in right now, what would it be?
I know this is going to be a very pedestrian answer, but I would stick with residential. And specifically, what I am looking at doing in the next couple of few months is buying off developers who are perhaps either in difficulty or they've just got the last of their development that they want to sell off in bulk. And that's residential developments. Mm-hmm. That said, I do think that commercial is so distressed right now and there's just no demand for it, but that will have to change. And these things are cyclical and anything that's out of favor will have to then turn and be in favor. So if I had the courage, I would be investing in commercial, but I don't have the courage and I like to sleep at night. So I'd probably just stick with residential finished stock or near complete.
All right. In terms of the UK market in general, everybody's talking about Brexit and housing prices, how they're influenced as a result. Do you have any sort of direction? Are you with those that say that the prices eventually will go up? Or what do you think? How is Brexit going to influence the market?
Yeah, it's a really tough one. I think what will be more influential on that is the tax increases that are coming in on foreign buyers from this year. And that has caused a run on prices. So prices in the UK were up, this is residential, were up 7.4% last year. And that's across the UK as a whole. So there clearly was a lot of pent up demand that caused this buoyancy in the prices. I'm not sure that's going to continue into this year. As I said, there are tax increases coming in on foreign buyers. The stamp duty holiday ends. And I think that a lot of people who were going to take up the Help to Buy option will have taken it up by then, because it's going to either cease or change by 2023, I believe. So there's a bit of time left on that. But it just seemed that everyone who had demand has exercised their desires, and now going forward, there'll be this, I think, a little bit of a glut. And we've got the full effect of furlough that's going to come through now, and also of the job losses. We've lost a lot of jobs here in the UK, and that has to have an impact on affordability and mortgages. The other thing about Brexit, it seems like it's kind of been like Y2K, if you can remember that. There was so much hype ahead of it. We all thought planes were going to fall out of the sky and our computers would stop working and our big bricks of mobile phones would stop as well. And it didn't happen. In the end, millions and billions were spent on, some would say unnecessarily, and some would say that's the reason why we avoided the massive crash and the issues that we had anticipated. And right. I think the same with Brexit is that now that it's happened, people are saying, well, that wasn't as bad as we thought. Let's just deal with what we've got. We've got the certainty now of this deal that's in place. So let's just soldier on. That seems to be the attitude that people are taking now. And that's the information that I'm getting from international commercial property investors.
Well, you know, actually, the certainty has a positive effect on the market. Absolutely. Most of the time. Yeah. So that actually is maybe an interesting consequence of post-Brexit, right?
Yes.
So you dabble in technologies and invested in a few companies. What about prop tech? Have you seen anything interesting in property technologies?
Yeah, I just had a really interesting conversation actually with someone who knows you actually, who was talking about the uptake of the property industry in technology and how I use the word laggard, and he pulled me up on that actually and said, no, I think that's a bit too full sweeping of the whole industry. But certainly the property industry as a whole has not been so quick to embrace the mobile interface and mobile technology. His view was that last decade was defined by how intimate we've become with our mobile phones. And his view is the next decade is going to be about augmented reality and how that is incorporated into our property journey. And already we're seeing this in various, because it's all about how it trickles down to those who actually use it rather than those who produce it and have it available. And so I'm seeing a number of architects who won't allow clients to sign off on their schemes until they've physically walked through with the headsets and touched and felt and had this user experience inside the new property, even if it's just a rear extension. So we are seeing that. And I do feel that, again, with the lockdown and with people becoming more used to an online world, we will see this uptake and in this augmented reality type. And even for conferencing and things like that, there's so many changes that have happened. And I think just picking up on the point you made at the beginning about the trends, I don't know if there are any new trends that we're seeing post-pandemic, but what we are seeing is an acceleration of trends that were already in play.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah, I love augmented reality. And in general, in real estate, I think as people are starting to enter the global real estate market and they want to buy something, you know, they want to know how it feels to be there. So absolutely, I think that's a great tool that is even useful for us at SolidBlock as we enable people to invest in real estate globally by buying a fraction of a property. So I absolutely see there is a synergy, and we actually have an augmented reality company that we're close with and working out a relationship in which we'll be using them for our properties. So tell me more about other companies you invested in.
Yeah, there's a range of them. There are some failures. I don't think you can ever talk about companies that you've invested in without failures. So I invested in a company that was probably a little ahead of its time, and perhaps if it was relaunching now, it might be successful. And that is an online bathroom design company where you could design and buy everything for your bathroom online. And I thought this was a great idea because otherwise...
I think so too.
Exactly. If you've ever tried to buy a bathroom, let alone a kitchen, and that was going to be the next stage. It's just so much nicer, I think, to just sit at home and say, right, I want that toilet. I want that then I want that, I want that. And does it all fit together? Yes, yes, no, choose this, choose that. And it spits it out and it gets delivered in a beautiful big palette. But yeah, unfortunately, it was a bit of ahead of its time. That was about 3 years ago and invested in that. So that didn't work out. And then I also invested in an online fitness wear for women. And again, I think it was a bit ahead of its time because it was 2 years ago and I bought that. And then I just had a bit of some problems in my property portfolio, which really needed my attention. And so I didn't have the time to focus on leading that business. I had a manager in place, but it really needed a leader. And so I let it just fall by the wayside. And it's sort of just ticking along now and in talks with people to perhaps take up that management again. But again, it was a bit ahead of its time because imagine if I'd had this leisure wear or lounge wear, fitness wear label pre-lockdown when I'm wearing leggings right now.
I know, so am I.
That's right. We put on a professional looking shirt.
I know. I have my jacket like right next to my Zoom. And then just a minute, just a second. There you go.
Exactly. So we just, it's all about comfort, isn't it? And clothes that can take you from comfort to meeting. And it's all about your top half now. So the sales of Zoom-worthy tops have just gone through the roof as everyone tries to get that. Yeah, that's really interesting. And I might do something with that again. But as far as prop tech, I have looked at some other things which I find really interesting. But again, I just don't have the time to do that right now. And I'm actually shedding things right now rather than taking on new things. And oh, actually, I know I invested in a really fantastic company I forgot to mention called Terrible Merch. It's a merchandise company for the music industry, but they had a really interesting app that they developed for live music. They're about to roll that out early 2020. And of course, live music stopped as we know it. And so they had to completely pivot their business model, which they've done. And again, I really love the founders of that business, Tertia and Jack. And Tertia is an outspoken advocate for the music industry and for women in that industry as well. So it's always really exciting to work with them and hear where they're going and to back their vision.
That's cool. So as you're Marie Kondoing your activity, what is your main focus going to be? Maybe your podcast?
Yeah, as I alluded to earlier, I went through a bit of a tough time, just relationship and professionally, and I'm always very open about that. And it really knocked my confidence. And I had to step back and think, right, what can I do that will help me restore some of my confidence in my ability to deliver? And I was working with a great coach at the time, actually I still am, and we explored that and we decided, or we worked out that it was my podcast that really brought me joy and it allowed me to do something that I enjoyed doing, gave me access to really great people. And it's now top 5% globally of podcasts. So clearly people are listening and enjoying that as well. So I've been doing that since 2017. So we just refreshed the format and rebooted that. And as I said, it's going really well. So
what's it called? What it's about?
It's really boring named, not boring in content, of course. And it's just called the Nicole Brumner Podcast because I couldn't come up with a great name like yours. Yours is so good. Solid block. How good is that? But I could not come up with a good name. Yeah, it's block solid, sorry. Yeah, I just could not come up with a good name. So it's the Nicole Brumner Podcast.
Yeah.
I'm actually launching a new one in the next couple of months too, which will be really interesting. So
a new podcast. So what is the Nicole Brumner Podcast about and what's the new one about?
My podcast is just about having conversations with really interesting people and talking about the journey that's got them to where they are and what makes them so passionate about that, and particularly looking at setbacks they might have had and how they've rebounded from those setbacks and got themselves into a position now. And there are just lessons around that. I found that having the network the size that I do, it just did give me access to these people. And I've got a really great lineup of people who want to be on the podcast, including yourself. And it's great to be able to delve into these stories, the real stories behind people. And I love that. Now, the podcast that is coming, I can't say too much, except that I feel that all podcasts seem to be looking at young people and celebrating youth and what I wanted to do is go back to our older generations and dig deep within the wealth of knowledge and just insight that they have. I'm realizing that the older I get, the less I know. And yet that has some power and some
wisdom.
Value.
Yeah.
Wisdom. So that's what we'll be doing. And we're just working out how we're going to do that now and working on a great podcast launcher to get that up and running. So we are really looking forward to that. And I don't think there's anyone doing it quite in the same way yet.
For sure. Well, at least you don't have to do the tech evangelism, because the majority of today's grandmas and grandpas know how to use Zoom. So that's good news for you, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And I understand what you mean about learning from the older generation. So powerful and so insightful. In Israel, we have, I think, close to 100,000 people still that are Holocaust survivors, for example. Every year we have like a Holocaust Remembrance Day where they usually come out and they talk about their experiences, and it's really humbling, right? And talk about all of their life story and journey. So you kind of, you celebrate their lives. So yeah, I wish you best of luck with it. It sounds like an amazing podcast, and I'm definitely going to check it out. I listened to a few of your podcasts and I absolutely love them, and I'm looking forward to the new ones coming out. Very cool. So you've invested into a few startups, and how do you decide on which startup to invest, and how do you do due diligence?
It's mostly about the people. And I think everyone says that when they're asked this question. But yeah, for me, it is about the people and also about how frugally they want to start out. And what really impressed me about Jack and Tertia and about Robin is that they were really prepared to sacrifice their own lifestyle in exchange for giving their companies the very best chance that they had at survival. And that was something that was lacking in the other startup that I invested in that failed. It was all about going to the very best branding agency, the very best marketing agency, and spending hundreds of thousands that we didn't have. Whereas with the other two companies, Terrible Merch and with Bamboo, they really scrimp and save and try and make do with what they have at the time. And if they need more, then go back to the investors, raise more capital, but in a really controlled way. When I see someone giving themselves $20,000-$30,000 a year in salary in order to help their company rather than taking hundreds of thousands, I want to back that, because that is what startups are all about. They're hard work, and it's not about being opportunistic with your investors' monies. It's about guarding those with the ultimate respect. So that's what I really like to see in a startup.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm 100% there with you. And I've seen that happen, and I've been a part of startups where I know that investors would see, like, the CEO took some sort of a 5-star hotel, and that already doesn't look good, you know? I've been always like staying in some scrunchy Airbnbs and stuff in like expensive towns like London and New York used to be, right? So that's definitely a bad sign for investors. I totally agree. I read about your sailing passion, and I'm really curious. Do you take all four of your kids on board when you go sailing?
Yeah, we've had 6 of the kids on board at one time before, which was very, very interesting, because we've got 8 between us. So
right.
I think the most we've had on board is, I think we've had about 9 of us in total, and that's on a 60-foot boat. So it's quite cozy. Yeah, it is a passion. And for me, it's a relatively recent passion in the last 3 years. And it's kind of the reason why I'm shedding things at the moment as well, because my partner, Paul, and I have this 5-year plan that we will gradually spend more time on the boat and less on land. And we're slowly tipping that balance at the moment. At the moment, it's land-based at the moment. We're on lockdown. But prior to that, we were spending around maybe 3 months on the seas and the rest of the time on land. And we want to gradually tip that so that we are spending the majority of our time just traveling around and working remotely. And so that's why I've really changed my focus in real estate and working remotely while also trying to run a large development project and all the various things that go along with that. It's just not conducive. So that's why really looking at other areas within real estate investment and also investment in general. I think that property people tend to be too evangelical about property investment and forget about other asset classes. And yeah, cryptocurrency, that's an asset class. And investing in startups, again, with any money that you're prepared to lose, is also an investment strategy. So I think that I just want to be a bit broader with my strategy and look at the portfolio and making sure it's balanced so that it fits within this lifestyle of sailing and exploring and just living a life with a bit more purpose, helping out where we can, if we can, in say the South Pacific. My family are all medics and I've always loved the way that they've been able to. My mum just drops into Cambodia and runs vaccination projects, and my stepfather can do all sorts of operations and minor operations. He's not a surgeon, he's a GP. And I think that there are ways that we, with our backgrounds, can help in various ways as well. It's not all just medical. And that just gives life a bit more purpose when you're exploring around.
That's amazing. So you're moving away from active real estate investment to more passive. And you said these new asset classes. So I'd love to hear about like what other types of real estate investments are there that you're considering, and maybe also security tokens.
Yeah, that's a good question. And I had not even considered it until we met last year. And I started looking at what you're doing. And yeah, it really excited me because I have got this. I'm not going to say that I understand everything, because I think what you do is can be quite complex and it needs processing, if you know what I mean. But yeah, when I looked through your packs and all the information, I thought, do you know what? This makes sense to me and I can see how this works. So it's something that I'm open to in the future.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, in general, it's quite similar to investing in a project directly. It is, in fact, investing in a vehicle that holds a project. But the idea is to give you flexibility of picking and choosing depending on when you want to come in, when you want to come out. Things are changing in the market, right? Then you see there is an opportunity in the hotel and you want to dabble a little bit in a distressed hotel, for example, or even not a distressed hotel. You can go and put in $20,000, $30,000 in that property. And then you want to exit, you just sell it out to somebody else, right? You don't want to hold it anymore.
That's the
idea of flexibility and possibly
and liquidity.
Liquidity working very well for people who want to live on boats.
Exactly. And I can see that, because that's the problem with real estate, is it's by nature of what it is. It's a non-liquid asset.
Yeah.
And yet by doing what you do with the fractional ownership, it gives real estate that liquidity and that flexibility. So to take a view on that. So yeah, no, it's very interesting and it's something I am going to look at.
Very cool. Very cool. So tell me a little more about your book. You published a book about how to create a stunning property portfolio and build a powerful brand while still having time for kids and family. Would you say it's more of a business book or a personal book?
It's a bit of both. And I wrote it at a time when everything was rosy and everything was going well. So I think if I were to write that book again, it would be very different, because I think that I've weathered some storms now and I have a bit more of a realistic view on things. However, it was my story or it is my story. And it was also a non-expert's view on how other people can use property as a way of creating some financial independence in their life. Certainly not get rich quick, because property's not that, but also just to create the flexibility in their life around a family, whether it be traveling and having the freedom of location, or around children, or again, a lot of people, they don't have children, but they're carers for their family. So around that sort of thing, it just gives flexibility. And I'm still an advocate for property as a whole, even though I'm a little jaded at the moment. But yeah, that's really, the purpose was to tell my story, I think.
That's awesome. So is there some methodology to this, to working under pressure of balancing family and work life and then succeeding in what you're doing? I think a lot of people have a problem with following through. They think, wow, I want to do something because I'm passionate about it, but then kind of life gets in the way. Is there some methodology you can recommend to be successful?
Yeah, I think the recommendation I'm going to give is also probably a little cautionary as well, because what I'm very good at, but it's also my flaw, is outsourcing. I'm very good at outsourcing. I get a great idea and I want it implemented. I'm very good at the first few steps. And then beyond that, I'm not very good at the implementing and ensuring that all the details are right. So when it comes to, I'm very good at say, right, let's get this great person who can do this part of the puzzle and this part and this part, and I'm going to outsource it all, and I'm just going to trust that it will all work smoothly and let it run, and I will just leave it and let people get on with it. And I'm very much ask forgiveness, not permission, in my approach to the way that I lead. And that is not always the best way to lead. So that is my flaw as well, and something that I'm trying to be better at. But that comes down to systems, doesn't it? And accountability, and just having things like Asana or whatever it might be, where you are actively checking off the tasks that people are supposed to be doing. And I've seen with my interactions with you, Yael, how good you are with the systems and the processes that you have in place with the various people within your team. And that's something that I think you have to do, and you have to be prepared that when you outsource, you never outsource 100%. You outsource maybe in the beginning 20%, and you can gradually dial that up as the people can prove themselves, but never outsource all of it. You always have to have some level of oversight and control over that. Otherwise, things can
get
out of hand.
Or you have a team, right, that you can delegate that to. So I agree with you 100%. And I also have that flaw to an extent. What I've been doing since actually 2009, I read a book called The 4-Hour Workweek.
Have you read that one? Tim Ferriss, yeah.
Yeah, with Tim Ferriss. And it changed my outlook in life. And there are many things in that book, and right now they're a little outdated, but it still stands, right? Obviously, when you're passionate about something, you're going to work on it more than 4 hours. But you know, you're doing that. You're not going to gradually go on a boat and spend more time with your family, right? If you really want to, you can work more. But the whole idea was that you can outsource, like you can outsource your life basically completely. And I started doing that to an extent, right? But then I realized certain things can be outsourced, and you know, with systems that you create, and usually those things that can stand mistakes, right? So, you know, if it's an email, or if it's, you know, even if you lose a customer, you lose a customer. But certain things like management, you cannot outsource, unfortunately. First of all, because nobody can do it as good as you can. And second, because, you know, that's your USP. So then I realized, you know, I stopped looking for other managers. And I realized, like you did, you have to scale your activity down. You just can't do everything. And things started changing for me when I co-founded SolidBlock. I joined my partner, Yuval. When things started changing for me, when I said, okay, this is the only thing I'm doing and nothing else, right? So now every other thing, like I'm writing a book and a podcast, is related to my activity in SolidBlock. So I appreciate you sharing that experience with me, and definitely lots of learning here. So real estate and online, that's something that you mentioned in the beginning of our conversation. So what other benefits do online investment vehicles have and offer to innovative smaller developers? We talked about the investors, obviously, who can come in and buy in terms of COVID, but in terms of the developers.
Yeah, in what way do you mean that? Sorry.
Yeah. All right. Let me rephrase that from the beginning. Okay. Turning back to putting real estate online and offering real estate to either retail investors or high net worth individuals, obviously there's lots of benefits for the investors. You know, they see the properties and so on. I'm wondering if this trend has created, you know, obviously it's created a lot of benefits for real estate owners as well, because it created offerings and so on. But I'm wondering how that affects the industry overall. Do we see it as a play of larger developers who have more budgets to market things online? Because now apparently you can do anything without putting a lot of budget to market. Or do you think that it offers opportunities to smaller developers as well?
Yeah, no, I do think that it's offering up opportunities to smaller developers. There are access to apps and processes now that were only available to larger developers. So, for example, virtual tours. You can pay someone £150 to come in and create a virtual tour of your property. Wow. Now, that anyone can afford that if they're marketing a property. The average house price in London now is over £600,000. So if you're not doing that, if you're not spending the £150 to whatever it's cost, then you're missing a trick. Yet it is what happens with all these technologies is that they start off at the top. It's the same with anything. It's the same with, say, modular construction, for example. They start off where only the biggest players can adopt them or adapt to them. And then as the economies of scale come down and more people are using those, the prices come down and the smaller developers can then adopt those various applications or methodologies. And that's definitely what we're seeing with online. And again, just to go back to the point I made, all these trends were in play already, but this has now just accelerated all of those. And that's what's so exciting about this online. And just the way, even it was unheard of to think of getting documents and contracts signed online. And now solicitors are accepting these for independent legal advice and everything. So that's a huge step forward for this industry.
Yeah, I hear you. It's incredible how fast our lives have become, you know, business and life, and how, you know, I understand your desire to disconnect on a boat. I think I'm going to move in that direction too. You know, I've signed up to go get a skipper license. So let's see how that goes. Yeah, maybe I'll come on my boat and visit you on your boat.
The boat's in Greece at the moment, so come and visit us in Greece.
Oh, wait, you're talking to me from Greece right now?
Or? No, I'm not in Greece. I'm in lockdown in London. Yeah, but no, the boat's in Greece. So
okay,
we spent a lot of time last year in Greece.
I love Greece. No, I thought, you know, maybe you brought your paintings with you on the boat.
Yeah, no.
Like a virtual background, you know. I miss my home. Yeah. Yeah, there they are. Yeah, amazing. So we're basically covered the majority of the topics I wanted to cover with you. But, you know, it's been so exciting to talk to you. I want to ask you one last question. What is your prediction for 2021, right? You can take it in any direction. So real estate, startup, world, peace, whatever you want. Like, what are you expecting to happen in 2021?
Yeah, I think that it comes down to health, time, loved ones, and how we use our leisure time. I think that what we're realizing that we don't have to commute. We don't have to go into the office so much. We really love and miss touch and spending time with our loved ones. I think we'll have a renewed sense of the time and the quality of time that we do spend with our loved ones. We might be absolutely sick to death of our children having got them homeschooling, but as far as our wider community, I think we will see that. And a lot of people are saying that people won't travel anymore, whereas I think that's absolutely wrong. I feel I've got this pent-up wanderlust where I just want to just get out of these walls that contain me right now. So I can't wait to travel.
What's the next place going to be? Is it Greece or?
Greece, definitely Greece to the boat as soon as we're allowed to. And I'd love to go to Australia. I've not seen my mom in 2 years. She's not seen her grandkids in 3 years. And it doesn't look like Australia's going to open up their borders even this year. So it's probably going to be 2022 before I see my mom. And that's going to be
incredible.
5 years not seeing her grandkids, which is a huge amount of time. So yeah, definitely Australia. And just, I want to touch people again. I want to shake hands. I want to give them a greeting on the kiss on the cheek. These sorts of things I really miss. I saw my best friend the other day and we were standing outside Shoreditch police station and I couldn't just hug her and hold her. And I was just there, we're both in tears going, I just want to hold you, Laura. And she's going, I know. As people, we crave touch, and I feel so fortunate that I'm here with all these children and my partner, but I do feel for people who haven't had that touch for so long. And
I know, for sure. You know, I watched an episode of Friends the other day, and all it's going through my head, oh my God, they used to hug. How can they do this? What are they doing? Stop. Where are your masks?
Yeah, I had meetings in person yesterday, all socially distanced with masks on. We were sanitizing keys before we handed them over. And even that act, it felt so wrong just passing a set of keys over to someone. But then it just feels weird not being able to shake hands and say, yeah, nice to meet you. So I think that as soon as we can, I think we'll have a renewed interest.
Appreciation.
And family and time. And
yeah.
It will probably move forward as a healthier society as well. So
absolutely. All of our company here in Israel, the employees in Israel, we all got vaccinated already. Yeah, we all got vaccinated. We tried really hard. You know, we're all younger than 60. So, or most of us are younger than 60. And we found a way because we have a startup. So we have to move forward. We have to travel. So I'm looking forward to that, to the ability to travel. And by the way, where in Greece do you usually sail?
Yeah, so anywhere. At the moment, the boat is just outside of Athens, so it's out on the hard at the moment, just having a few repairs and some general maintenance. And then hopefully as soon as we can get out, we will just, we'll use Athens as a base for the next 2 years and just explore all the islands and see how far we can get. And, yeah, hopefully get as far as, next in 2 years, in 3 summers' time, we'd even like to go through the Black Sea and do all around the Black Sea area as well.
That's cool. I was born there. I was born in the Crimea.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And my father had a boat together with his partners. So we spent a lot of time on the boat. It was a beautiful yacht. It was made of redwood. It was a sailboat. And they tried to go on that boat, I think, to Italy. And I think the motor broke somewhere around Turkey. So, but it wasn't, I don't think it was geared towards going that far. But yeah, it was definitely a beautiful, beautiful boat. So I can connect to your experience. I grew up on the sea, on the beach, surfing and diving. So can't wait for us to meet up in Greece. But until then, thank you so much for coming on and joining me on the Block Solid podcast today, Nicole. You can find us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or by visiting our website at solidblog.co/podcast. If you enjoyed the show, don't forget to rate and review and spread the word. Thanks for listening. See you next time.
Thank you, Gail. Bye.